Good morning. How's everybody today? Are you blessed and highly favored? And are you flavored? We're to be the salt to this world, right? Not the pepper. There's enough pepper going on. Praise God. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it because we have a choice to rejoice. It's too bad many people's influences by the demonic realm are causing them to choose miserable, wrong things. You know, it's amazing to me that people who claim to be believers still don't get influence. What's your influence? Oh, that's just me. No, it isn't you. What's your influence? Who's influencing you? I don't know. Because people never can, they don't take the time. And the reason in the arena of this is that's why Jesus commanded something very powerful. He said, before you go out, as you are going to be my children, not only am I required for you to be born again, but it's required you to be filled with my Holy Spirit. Why? Because you will not be able to discern or overcome. You'll be religious. The enemy will use you. You'll do many mistakes. You'll make choices in how you feel. You'll make choices by the words that you think that are not even from you, they're from the enemy. But you will not be able to discern the influence because you're not walking in the Spirit. Everybody got it? That's why he required, he commanded everyone, be filled with the Holy Spirit. People become religious. There's a difference between religion and a son of God or a daughter of God. There's a difference. And God is doing a great work and a mighty work and a quick work. He is bringing counsel, correction, direction, and conviction. Most people don't even read the Bible. They call themselves believers. The word believe means to follow. So if you say that you're a believer, that means you are following and you're submitting to the Word of God. The Word of God says that submit to God. Then you'll be able to resist the devil. Other than that, you can't resist him and you're still a son of the devil or a daughter of the devil. Why? Because you cannot, you're not doing God's will. Or only those who do God's will enter the kingdom of God. Not good people. Only righteous. See, there's a tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and there's a tree of life. And only those who partake of the tree of life will enter life. We have entered a time and season where people just still are doing the doctrine of the devil. They do what they feel like doing. They're not even taking the time. Most people don't even worship God. They don't get into the Word. They don't come in fellowship. Oh, I don't want any organized religion. Me either. But the Word says, forsake not to assemble. Why? Because there's unity. There's power in the unity. Oh, I ain't going to church. I just don't believe in any of that stuff. It's okay. You're just demonized. Who told you that you're not to come to fellowship? Who told you? See, they're not even monitoring their thoughts. And the enemy's got them bound. See, only through the anointing of Christ Jesus can you break these things. And it's time for these things to be broke off of people's lives. If Jesus was to show up right now and ask, what have you done? And what are you doing for me? Or do you know me? Because he's going to tell a lot of people, I don't know you, depart from me. Remember, who you serve when you die is where you go. But I've been a believer 25 years. Well, you ain't been believing too much because you ain't been following. If you're still serving the devil, you can't be a believer. And when you die, the demons come and get you and the angels will not. See, people don't take this seriously. Because while we're in this realm right now, in this temporary place, one day you're going to give up your breath and you'll stand before God. And that moment, you stand before God. This whole time here will be like a one-night sleep. For some of us, it'll be a dream, and for some of us, it'll be a nightmare. And you can't say nothing then. You can't bring your attorney, your family, or your pastor. You can't bring nobody. It's you and him. He'll open the book of remembrance when you try to justify anything. And say, Well, you've never repented for this, 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 and this. In fact, you didn't forgive these people. In fact, you steal this, you lie. You still do drugs, you do this. You're a drunkard. You come against my will. And you call yourself good. Depart from me, I don't know you. And then demons come and get that person. This is reality. This is reality. This is real. This is what's happening. Every one of us, we all bleed the same, don't we? It doesn't matter what race, what color, whatever. We all bleed the same. Everyone comes from the same place. The problem is not everyone is going to go home to the same place. And God sent you into this world to fulfill a mission. Not your mission, His mission. Because it's a temporary place. Amen? It's temporary. We are in right now an arena. Jesus came and started something very powerful. He started freedom. People were bound up, man. All this religious stuff, doing rituals. Never could truly have a relationship with God. Only until Jesus came and set it right. He came to restore our true DNA. It's an eternal DNA. He came to give me a new power to say no to the enemy. He came and gave us weapons. Most people don't even know how to use the weapons of God. He came to give us the kingdom that we may participate and live in the kingdom and be under the rule of another government, not this government. This is all temporary. Everyone look at each other and say, you're temporary. Everything's temporary in this realm. Thank God we're not going to look like this when we go home, man. So stop looking in a mirror and letting the mirror tell you who you are. That ain't you. Most people don't even know who they are anyways. They're still looking for their identity. They're trying to find it in sports, money, success, relationships. That's who they're trying to identify, who they are. You are Christ. You are His. Your identity is in Him and nothing else. If it's in anything else, it's an idol. Turn to Genesis chapter 2. He came for truth, right? Amen. Glory. If you don't have a Bible, we have some. Or you can share it. Because the word doesn't return void. Genesis chapter 2. In verse 4. Now what you speak is what you eat is what you become, right? So if we speak light, we eat light. So we speak life, we eat life. And this is the history of the heavens and of the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. Before any plant of the field was in the earth and before any herb of the field had grown, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the earth, and there was no man to till the ground. In other words, he was saying something very important. It wasn't about looking for a garden keeper. He was looking for someone to rule the earth. Because Lucifer had been removed from ruling the earth. But he was now, Lucifer at one time ruled the earth. He was a ruler of the earth. The earth was inhabited by angels. And because when Lucifer disobeyed God, God removed him from his position. So the earth at a period of time was what we call chaotic. They call it the Ice Age. God closed off the sun to it, closed off everything. And then he sent the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of breath, the Spirit of life, to hover over the earth. And things began to move away. The sun began to shine. Things began to happen. And he created a man called Adam to rule the earth, not to just go around and pull out weeds because there wasn't any weeds. In verse 6, But a mist went up from the earth and watered the whole face of the earth. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and did what? Breathe into his nostrils the what? Breath of life. And man became a living being. I want you to understand something. This was the beginning of the ministry of life. This was the ministry of life. Life. Existence. And it was by his spirit. God took clay and made a man out of it. First, God spoke himself and created the clay. He created the heavens and the earth. He created time. And we know that there's a beginning and an end, and everything's going to close up soon. But we still have 1,000 years, millennium to enter. But there's a feast that's getting ready to happen. It's called the Feast of Trumpets. And only those who are right with God will be removed. The rest will go through wrath. And you don't want to go through the wrath. Because you'll either starve to death, beheaded, or unless you can hide somewhere and not get caught until the Lord returns. And just don't take the mark. As long as you don't take the mark, you got a chance. But this is coming soon. And he's only going to remove those that are right with him. Why? Because those that will be left rejected the ministry of life. They did what? They rejected the ministry of life. Only those will be taken if accepted and are doing the ministry of life. Is everybody all right? It says, and the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. See, the problem is still people are eating off the tree of good and evil, not tree of life. See, God had no man to rule. So what he was doing, he was creating a man. He breathed in him. He breathed the breath of God. He shared his spirit and put it into a piece of clay and called it a living being. Because it says here that, it go back to Genesis 1 and verse 26. It says, and God said, let us make man in our image. In our what? Image according to our what? Likeness. That means character. Let him have dominion over the... In other words, he was creating Adam with authority. The problem is Adam didn't know how to use it yet. Because Adam really didn't even know his identity yet. That's why God had him in the garden to train him and Eve up. So they would learn how to use authority. So they'd be trained to rule. But the serpent deceived them. They never fulfilled to get their true identity. And they were taken out. And that's what the enemy wants to do to us. He wants us never to reach the place of our true identity. Or he wants to come to steal it when you get it. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. Again, the only ones that were created in the image of God was Adam. Eve was created in the image of Adam. So everybody got it. And from that point on, things changed, especially when they fell. So Adam was born with authority and power. The only way that he can maintain this authority and power is by partaking of the tree of life. It's amazing how many people think that they can walk as a Christian, which means Christ-like, and still not partake of the tree of life. It's impossible. The enemy will eat you up. And you won't even know you're being eaten up. So God breathed into the created body the spirit of life, the breath of God. Adam was created in the image likeness of God, but had to be trained to use his authority by gaining knowledge of his identity. Is everybody okay? Ministry of life. Ephesians chapter 2. Ministry of Life. Hallelujah. Ministry of Life. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1. And let's speak it together. Is everybody there? And he says, "And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to what? The course of this world, according to the what? Prince of the power of the air," or the prince of the power of breath. Does everybody get it? Because there was another presence, another spirit. The serpent that was in the garden was known as the prince of power of air, breath. Why? What he did is contaminated. He contaminated the breath that God placed in man. "And among whom also we all once..." "In which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of air, the prince of power of breath," the what? "The spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience," or rebellion, "among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh, of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others." So, I'm going to back up a little bit. I'm going to share a couple things with you. Some of you probably don't even know or never heard. It's never been preached to you. First of all, you and I are born in darkness. We are actually known as children of the offspring of Lucifer or Satan. We're known as children of the devil. In fact, it says it right here. Because we are born under the prince of power of air. It was a different breath. When Adam and Eve fell, and they fell to lust, the serpent seduced Eve and produced two children. And from that point on, it continued. That's why the Lord brought judgment on the woman and said, "You'll be in pain for the rest of your life for giving birth." Does everybody understand? You're not going to hear this in, you know, Sunday school. Because there's a deep arena of understanding of the Word of God through the Spirit of God. It's different. Changed the DNA of everything. Brought forth giants into the world. They're called Nephilim. And that DNA still continued. That's why God destroyed the earth with the flood. But they got through because one of Noah's sons married a Nephilim. Didn't know it. And that's where you got Cain and all the Canaanites, Hittites and Amorites and Perizzites and all the other sites and ites and whatever. And they all became giants, and God went out and said, "Kill them all, their children, everything." Because they were offsprings of fallen angels and man. And when they died, their spirits became demons. So those spirits need a body. "Well, I'm a Christian, I can't have a demon." Well, you already have one. It's called a lion one. All Christians can have demons. And one of the things the enemy wants to do is get you to touch something unclean so they come back. The Word of God says that when the unclean spirit leaves a body, it goes and gets others. Stronger to try to get you to fall, to open your mouth, or agree with something from the devil so they can re-enter you. And you won't know they're there. Sometimes everybody else might. You might not know they're there. Because they like to come dormant. There's only times when they come up to get fed. And they get fed by emotion. That's why the spirit of oppression, spirit of addiction, spirit of fear, anxious, anger, hatred, murder, all of these things feed spirits. Provoking spirits. So in this has been passed down the line now. So these demons exist. They're all over the place. They're ruled by the prince of power of air, the breath of the devil. That's why you and I must be born again. Is everybody okay? The prince of power of air, the breath, that works in the sons of disobedience because they are not of the breath of God, which brings a new creation. In John 20, so Jesus came as the Christ, the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty, who was actually the breath of God. He said, man, you guys can't do it this way. I've got to come. John chapter 20. Oh, yes. Is everybody okay? In verse 19. John 20, verse 19. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled, for the fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, peace be with you. In other words, Jesus rose from the dead. And the disciples, the word says that Jesus was hanging out on the earth after he rose from the dead for 40 days. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side where he had been pierced, and the nails had gone through him. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also do what? Send you. Remember, this whole thing started off with the ministry of life. Jesus came to restore the ministry of life because it had been the ministry of death from that point on. And when he said this, he breathed. He did what? He breathed on them and said what? Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive sins of any, then they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. What authority. So Jesus, before he departed, he said, receive the Holy Spirit. He was given them enough power of his presence to make it for 10 more days until he poured out his Spirit. The problem was, out of the 500 he told to go to the upper room and wait in Acts 1, only 120 showed up. They're the ones that received the anointing, the power, the breath of life, and the breath of ministry. See, you and I have been granted the ministry of life. What an awesome thing. But see, the world wants to keep you entangled so you don't even know who you are. Keep you busy. We're working for this, working for that, trying to build this, trying to build that. They're building their own empire instead of the kingdom. The word says something powerful. If you'll seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, whoa, that means you're going to have to eat of the tree of life. All things will be added to you. They'll be what? Added to you. So in this, what Jesus was doing is he was breathing on him. He breathed. The breath of God carries his words, the breath of God. God reset a time clock. He reset time. And a ministry of breath or the ministry of life. He's called the Holy Spirit. He is the Spirit of the Father. And he's the breath of the Father. That's why when Jesus was here, he said, I don't do anything unless I see my Father or hear my Father. I don't come to do these things. It's not me that speak, but my Father that speak. Why? Because the Spirit that was in him, the breath that was in him, was the Father. So that's why if you see me, you see the Father. But he was called the Christ because he was carrying the eternal power and presence of God Almighty through the breath. In fact, Jesus' body was not made from clay. It was made from the Word. That's why when the devil came, he said, he ain't got nothing in me. He's got nothing in me. He couldn't touch his flesh. Nor could he touch his soul or his spirit. Because Jesus was one. His spirit, soul, and body were one. See, that's how Adam was created. There was no division between the spirit, soul, and body. Because the word says a house divided cannot stand. That's why when it got divided by agreeing, by the deception of the enemy, by the seduction of the enemy, they fell. In Job 33. Again, there's many who are fighting the unseen realm. They're fighting demonic spirits, unclean spirits that are influencing people. It isn't your wife. It's not your boss. It's not your pastor. It's a spirit that's influencing someone to get to you. Hallelujah. Job 33, in verse 1. Is everybody there? It's the employment section. Please, but please, Job, hear my speech and listen to my words. Now I open my mouth. My tongue speaks in my mouth. My words come from my upright heart. My lips utter pure knowledge. The Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of Almighty God gives me life. Now, is that powerful or what? The Spirit of God has made me, but the breath of Almighty God has given me life. I could go on. You can read that later, all the way up to verse 18. It's good. The breath of God carries His words. They are creative words of God. In fact, His words are justice, judgment, conviction, creation. His words create. That's how miracles happen. And His word will not return void if it's backed by the Spirit, if it's backed by the anointing. That's why He said you must be filled with the Spirit of God. Many people don't get that yet. I hear a lot of religious people go, yeah, I got filled and baptized in the Holy Spirit when I accepted Jesus. Praise God. Well, let's pray then. Our Father who art in heaven. No, bro. I said, let's pray in the Spirit. Well, I am praying. No. Then you ain't been baptized because there's always evidence of tongues. Look, when the Spirit of God comes in you, let me tell you, every gift is available. Every gift. It's no longer you that live, but Him. You've entered a whole nother realm. You're out of the outer court into the holy place. See, there's three chambers in the tabernacle. Everything revolves around the chambers of the tabernacle of God. Now you're fulfilling priesthood. See, the first office you must fulfill is priesthood or priestess. It's one who ministers to the Lord. Because as you minister to Him, He ministers to you. Then you're able to minister the ministry of life. John 3, verse 1. Aren't you glad we're not religious? God, I would have been stoned. Hey, one day, listen, I was fighting with wearing reading glasses because I didn't want to come. Lord, I know You can give me sight to see. Yes, I know You can give me more. Well, I was fighting. One day, I was reading a scripture at a service, and it talked about a landowner, about the vineyard and the landowner. Well, I said, yes, the lawnmower. I said, wait a minute. I realized then I had to submit and get some reading glasses because I didn't want to call the landowner a lawnmower anymore. Sometimes you just got to surrender to some things, you know, but you got to wait on God. He said, guy, go get some reading glasses. You want me to heal you? Go get the reading glasses. You know, some people, oh, Lord, heal this headache. Oh. Take some Advil. No, I ain't taking Advil. All right, keep the headache. See, Jesus is simple. He's healed me many times. Broken legs, broken arms, broken everything. Many times, in days. Told I couldn't walk for 4 months. Within 3 days, I was up running. That happened at a service. All kinds of things. We've seen people get healed, getting healed, being paralyzed, all kinds of stuff. We had a brother get healed Friday night. And plus, who knows? Whatever. God, look at God hasn't changed. Amen? He's still the healer. But you want to seek. You know, one of the things that Jesus said, he said their faith wasn't up to, I couldn't heal them. They weren't willing to receive. You know why? Because many people challenge God and don't accept what he says. They want to show me. He ain't going to show you nothing. You'll stay right the way you are. Verse 1. Is everybody all right? Let's read it. There was a man, a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night. He came by night because he didn't want anybody to know. He might have got thrown out of the Sanhedrin club. Then he couldn't use the hot tubs and all the other stuff. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly I said to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, the kingdom of God is peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit and power. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? What a dummy. And Jesus answered and said, most assuredly I say to you, no! Unless one is born of water, which through repentance, and of the Spirit, of the breath of life, the breath of God, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit or breath is spirit or breath. Do not marvel that I've said this to you. You must be born again. Why do you need to be born again? Because we were under the born with the prince of power of air, the prince of power of breath, which is sons and daughters of disobedience. We needed to get another breath. And it ain't changing nothing by giving yourself a mint. You need the breath of God. He confirms this by saying the next thing. He says, the wind or the breath blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So everyone who is born of the Spirit, born of the breath of God. Why? Because we are led. There's a difference. We are different. We're no longer temporary. We're eternal. See, if you've died yourself already, you can't be killed. So when the devil tries to kill you, you say, you can't kill someone who's already dead. Dead to yourself. Alive in the Spirit. It's a different realm. You've entered a whole nother realm. Everything. Even though you're living here, you don't live here. The Word says that you are blessed every spiritual blessing in what? Seated. You are now seated in heavenly places with Christ. You are not only a joint heir of Christ, but you are the righteousness of God when you are born of the Spirit. But to maintain it, you must continue to eat of the tree of life so you can fulfill the ministry of life. Is everybody cool? Woo! Jesus explained they must partake. Oh, let's go to John 8 or John 6. John 6. Ministry of life. What an awesome thing, you know what? Well, I want to be a minister. Man, it's got nothing to do with being a minister. It has nothing to do with being a pastor. It has nothing to do with these things. We are ministers of life. Life. You carry the presence of God Almighty in us. You have a ministry of life. You can be near anyone. That person can be headed to hell, and you can give him life by introducing him to the master of life. But without him, you're going to cook. John 6, 60. John 6 and verse 60. Now, Jesus was explaining to the people and the disciples, man, you got to eat of my flesh and drink of my blood. And they're like, what? Man, this is a cult. We get called all kinds of names. You got to drink of my blood and eat my flesh, Jesus told them. But they didn't get it. They didn't understand. He was talking about eating the Word of God and drinking the Spirit of God. And it says here in verse 60, therefore many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can understand it? When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, does this offend you? What then if you could see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives what? The Spirit who what? Life. Gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were and who would not believe and who would betray him. Jesus explained. This is so powerful. Then he said, therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless what? Has it been granted to him by my what? By my Father. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered and said to him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the what? Words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Wow. Again, Jesus explains to them that they must partake of the tree of life, which is his flesh and blood, his word and his spirit. And again, many of them didn't understand and they rejected. They got offended. Why? Because that's the only way you maintain life. And it's the only way you maintain the ministry of life. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Now here's something pretty wild, which may be. You didn't choose this. Everyone say, I didn't choose this. God chose it for you. So since God chose it for you, what are you going to do with it? You're going to put it aside, put it on the shelf, reject it? Snap. You'll go through hell before you get to heaven. It's a terrible thing to reject the call of God. And you're not here by coincidence today to hear this message. For some of us, it may be your last chance. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 4. Or somewhere around there. 2 3, verse 4. Yes, verse 4. Let's read it. And we have such trust through Christ toward God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the, that word spirit means breath. So it is the ministry of the breath of God. For the what? Letter kills, but the spirit gives life. But if the ministry of death written and engraved on stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses, where the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away, how will the ministry of the Spirit or the ministry of what? Life not be more glorious? For if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more. For even what was made glorious had no glory in this respect because of glory that excels. For if what is passing away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious. Therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. But their minds were blinded, for until this day the veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament because the veil is taken away in Christ. But even to this day when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart, on their mind, on their eyes. They can't see. They can't receive. They can't accept it. Nevertheless, when one turns to what? To the Lord, that veil is taken away. Now he's going to explain who the Lord is. Why? Watch this. Now the Lord is the what? The Lord is the what? Spirit. Why? Because he's the Father's Spirit. He is called Lord. That's why he's called Holy Spirit. Because he's the Spirit of God Almighty. He's the breath of God. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the what? Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom or liberty. Now where the breath of God is, there is freedom. The breath of God. But we all with unveiled face beholding in the mirror the glory of the Lord are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord or by the breath of God. Again, the ministry of the Spirit is a ministry of life. It is the breath of God. It means it's a ministry of existence. Existence. Freedom. Freedom. There isn't anything greater than freedom. People are tormented. They live in torment. They live in fear. They live in anxiety and stress. They're so caught up in the things of the world. They're actually searching for their identity and they're not finding it. They're trying to find it in their work, and some people are trying to find it in ministry. That's not your identity. Your identity is in Christ, life. Life. Romans 8. Hallelujah. Romans 8, verse 1. Let's speak it. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who what? Who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Ooh, this is so powerful. Why? Because according to the flesh is under the prince of power of air. But according to the Spirit is under the breath of God, the ministry of life. He says, verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life. There is a law. There is a requirement to maintain the Spirit of life, the Spirit of breath, or the ministry of life. He said, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in it that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. That the what? Everyone say righteous requirement. That means that there is a requirement. The righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh or the prince of power of air, but according to the Spirit of God, the breath of God. And the only way to do it is to continue to eat from the tree of the life, not the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. See, people go to college and get the knowledge of good and evil. And don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with it. But that ain't your source. But when you begin to eat from the tree of life, you get wisdom from above, which uses the wisdom that they give you in the schools. And you turn it to the good. Did you ever wonder why there's two serpents on the medical ambulance? Hello? Why? Because they eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, not from the tree of life. Or else they have on the side of the ambulance, Jesus heals. You don't see that anywhere. In fact, when you drive by a bar, what does it say? Come on in. Here we have food and spirits. They really need to erase it and write food and demons. Let people really know the truth. So the righteous requirement is to continue to eat of the tree of life. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit, for to be carnally minded is death, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity, it hates the things of God. For it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can it be. So then those who are in the flesh, under the rule of the prince of power of error, cannot please God. But you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. Ooh. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit of life because of what? Righteousness. See, there's an area that you will produce the fruits of righteousness because you're eating of the tree of life, which is actually the tree of righteousness. So you will produce fruits of righteousness. And that area of righteousness means that you are walking in the character of Christ. You approve what he approves of and disapproves of everything he disapproves of. Amen? Oh, yes. Go to Proverbs 15. Proverbs 15. Training for reigning. This is not a Bible study. This is a training session. You're holding in your hand a manual of eternity. Guidelines. In this book, it brings counsel, correction, and direction. And when it brings counsel, correction, and direction, it brings protection. Hallelujah. Proverbs 15 and verse 16. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together. Better is a little with fear of the Lord than great treasure with trouble. Better is a dinner of herbs where love is than a fatted calf with hatred. A wrathful man stirs up strife, but he who is slow of anger always allows contention. The way of a lazy man is like a hedge of thorns, but the way of the upright is what? A highway. A wise son makes a father glad, but a foolish man despises his mother. Folly is joy to him who is destitute of discernment, but a man of understanding walks upright. Now go to verse 1. You there? Let's speak it. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. The tongue of the wise uses knowledge what? Rightly. But the mouth of fools pours forth foolishness. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness in it breaks the spirit. A fool despises his father's instructions, but he who receives correction is prudent. In the house of the righteous there is much treasure, but in the revenue of the wicked is trouble. The lips of the wise despise knowledge, but the heart of fools does not do so. The sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the what? The prayer of the upright is his delight. The way of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but he loves him who follows righteousness. In other words, your tongue will bring life or death. Your tongue has the power of life and death. Why? Because what you speak is what you eat, and what you eat is what you become. So when you speak the words of life, more life comes. That's how you get healed more. Lord, I thank you that by your stripes I'm healed. I command this pain to leave me in the name of Jesus. What are you doing? Look at it. It's only breath that penetrates every particle. It's only breath. It's only breath that goes through. And it enters the other realm only through breath. It's the breath of life that brings life. So if you are convinced and you know it, see, one of the things the Bible says, it says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge because they don't even know it. They don't know that what they're speaking is going forth and penetrating. It's breaking the power of darkness in the area of sickness and disease and pain. It will restructure any part of your body. Because you were created by the word. Hello? And you were born again by the breath of life that brings life. So as you speak these things, you're eating these things. So you speak to these areas of your body for healing. I have to speak to my knees occasionally. I decree in the name of Jesus that these legs be strong. That my knees be healed. That every scar tissue be fixed and healed and removed. You know, scar tissue is a terrible thing. Many of us have scar tissue in our hearts. Emotional scar tissue that needs to be healed. What you speak life or death. When you take the words of creation and speak them, they are penetrating. But everything is according to your faith. How much do you believe? And then we know God has a specific time for everything, doesn't he? He says, seek, right? And you'll what? Find. Knock. Slam. Beat. And the door will be open. 2 Corinthians 5. Are we there? Verse 16. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the what? The flesh, which is under the prince of power of air, right? Or, now we know Jesus wasn't under the prince of power of air, do we? But he was in the physical realm, wasn't he? Amen? Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus what? No longer, because Jesus does not look like he used to. If you were to see him now, you'd freak out. Verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a what? New creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become what? New. Therefore, if anyone is in the kingdom of Christ and doing the requirements to maintain through the law of the Spirit, he's a new creation. Now we want to maintain that new creation. It says, old things have passed away. In other words, they are passing away. But the more you eat of the tree of life, the more you begin to decree life. Why? Because it's the ministry of life. The more you change. The more you change. The more you change. The more you get healed. The more you live healthier. The more you prosper. It says, even as your soul prospers, hello, everything will come. Now, all things are of God who has what? Reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of what? Reconciliation. Verse 18. Now all things are of God who has what? Reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. The ministry of reconciliation is a comeback from dead to life. That is that God was in Christ. His spirit, his breath was in Jesus. Reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and is committed to us, you and me, the what? Word of reconciliation or the ministry of life. Woohoo! Now what? Verse 20, come on, read it with me. Now we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be what? Reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. We then are workers together with him, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Whoa. Galatians 6. That speaks for itself. There ain't nothing to say about that. In verse 7, training for reigning. Let's speak it. Verse 7, do not be what? Don't be deceived or stupid. Don't be deceived. Don't be misled. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, he shall also what? Listen, that law is for the believers and unbelievers. Nobody escapes it. Verse 8. For he who sows to his flesh will of the reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap what? Everlasting life. Hello. In other words, what you speak is what you eat, what you sow. So if you're sowing into the spirit of breath, the breath of life, my goodness, you're going to get life. Some people don't get that. They stand in praise and worship. Oh, God, you're so holy. Look around the room. No, man, you're to sow. Because if you're without sowing, you don't escape. You sow till you sow what? Don't get religious on me. I hate when they say, let's take a moment of silence. For what? Silence ain't doing nothing. We're going to take a moment of silence for this person. Let's praise God, and hopefully they made it home. Hallelujah. Verse 9. And let us not grow what? Weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we don't what? Lose heart. Don't give up. Don't stop sowing. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Glory to God. Romans 8. Got to get this in. It's a requirement. I have to be obedient too. Nobody escapes that. Romans 8, verse 12. Let's speak it. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will what? You're going to die. You mean I'm a good person, though. You're going to die. But I feed the and clothe, and I do this, and I do that. Yeah, I know I fornicate, and I know I smoke dope, and I know I drink. But you're going to die. You're not going home. That's not fruits of righteousness. See, when you have fruits of righteousness, it means you are right standing with God. Not what man says. Not what the government says, for sure. Just because the government approves something doesn't mean it's good. Hello? Look what they're doing now. My goodness. The word says no homosexual, lesbian, or anything is going to enter the kingdom of God. Those are nothing but demons in people. And because they're practicing wickedness, they cannot enter. Hallelujah. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But by the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the body, you will what? Verse 14, are you ready for this one? For as many as are led by the breath of God or the Spirit of God, these are what? These are sons and daughters of God Almighty. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but the spirit of adoption, where we cry out, Abba, Father, which means Daddy. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, and if heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be what? Glorified together. Are you ready? Let's go a little further. For I consider that the what? Sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the what? Sons of God, they're waiting for us. Who? For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption and the glorious liberty of the children of God. That's me and you. Romans 1. Romans 1, verse 16. Let's speak it. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifested in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Turn to your neighbor and say, we have no excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Therefore also God gave them up to uncleanness in lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Wow. These people need rescuing. They need you to carry the ministry of life. And I want to close at 1 Peter 1. First Peter chapter 1. Hallelujah. First Peter chapter 1 and verse 13. Let's speak together. Is everybody there? Therefore what? Gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts of your ignorance, as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father who is without partiality, judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you are not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifested in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit and sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all glory of a man is the flower of the grass. The grass withers and its flowers falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word by which the gospel was preached to you. And Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Let this word penetrate every part of our being, establishing the divine nature and character. That the ministry of life, because you have given life, would be expressed through each and every one of us. Again, I ask that you continue to position us towards no longer we that live, but you that live. And put a thirst and hunger into each and every one to want to know you, behold you, and seek out their true identity in you, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.